ब्रेस्ट कैंसर इज डिवाइडेड इनटू वेरी फोर टाइप्स मॉलिक्यूलर सब टाइप्स व्हिच इज बेस्ड ऑन द ट्रांसक्रिप्शन प्रोफाइल्स. HER2 इनरिच सब टाइप इज वन ऑफ देम. इट कंस्टिट्यूट्स 10 to 15% ऑफ ऑल ब्रेस्ट कैंसर. इट ओवर एक्सप्रेसेस बोथ HER2 एंड प्रोलिफरेशन एसोसिएटेड हार्मोन रिसेप्टर रिलेटेड जीन्स. द मेजॉरिटी ऑफ क्लिनिकली HER2 पॉजिटिव ब्रेस्ट कैंसर्स फॉल इनटू लिमिनल बी सब टाइप, व्हाइल HER2 इनरिच सब टाइप इज ऑलमोस्ट ऑलवेज ERPR नेगेटिव. Human epidermal growth factor receptor, it is a family. It consists of total four types. First is EGFR1, HER2, HER3, and HER4. Deregulation in this family leads to the activation of downstream pathways, which results in tumor development and also affects treatment efficacy. HER receptor, it has three parts. First is an extracellular domain. Second is the helical transmembrane segment, and third is the intracellular protein tyrosine kinase domain. The extracellular region contains four domains, 1, 2, 3, 4. Ending, while the two, that is the dimerization arm, promotes direct receptor-receptor interaction. This is the HER1, this is the HER2. It acts without ligand, and it is a homodimerization. This is HER2 and HER1 heterodimerization, which happens in presence of a ligand. This is HER3 and HER2, again heterodimerization, which happens in the ligand like Herguline. And this is again HER2 and HER4, which happens in the presence of ligands like Herguline, Neurguline. After this homo or heterodimerization, the tyrosine kinase receptor pathway proceeds, which ultimately results in nuclear transcription and cell cycle progression, proliferation, and survival of the cells. As the specific ligand called Herguline, but it doesn't have any kinase activity. HER2 doesn't have any ligand, so-called orphan receptor, but it shows a tyrosine kinase activity. HER2 is activated through homo or heterotypic interaction of its extracellular domain with that of the HER receptors. In the absence of ligand binding, HER1 and HER3 exist in a tethered conformation in which the intramolecular interaction between domain 2 and domain 4 blocks the function of dimerization domain 2. Ligand binding to HER receptors changes the tethered conformation to undergo dimerization. HER2 extracellular region has a fixed conformation, and domain 2 loop is exposed to interaction. This constitutive exposure of its dimerization arm explains why HER2 is the favored partner for other ligand-dependent HER. High levels of HER2 present on the surface of HER-positive tumors also facilitate a spontaneous formation of HER2 dimers. Apart from gastroesophageal junction and breast carcinoma, HER2 implication is also found in tumor types like salivary gland, vaginal, bladder, endometrial, cervix. The various methods are immunohistochemistry, which is done in FFPE tissue, that is fresh frozen, that is formalin fixed tissue. In this slides are incubated with an antibody detected against the HER2 protein labeled, and protein is made visible with a chromosome, resulting in a membrane staining. The advantages are: it is easy to perform, cheap, less time consuming, and no special equipment needed. But the limitations are: it is affected by the pre-analytical factors. The next is FISH, FFP specimen. It is done by fluorescent labeled probe hybridization with the target tumor DNA and detected upon excitation of the fluorochromes and visualized using fluorochrome microscope. It is more reliable, more sensitive, and reproducible and accurate. However, it is more time consuming and more expensive. Next is the instant quality FISH. It is the detection mechanism is same as FISH, only the hybridization buffer is different. It decreases the assay time by one day only. Next is the ELISA. It is done on the blood sample using two monoclonal antibodies recognizing the epitopes of HER2 extra domain, incubated with the second monoclonal antibody, which is labeled with horseradish peroxidase. After applying horseradish peroxidase, substrate detection is accomplished by assessing third in product with the spectrophotometry. And most important, it can be used to monitor dynamic changes of the HER2 status. But it is not reliable if the samples are obtained from the patients receiving the trastuzumab. The next is the next generation sequencing. It is again done in formalin fixed tissue. The DNA extraction, library construction, hybrid capture, sequencing, and sequence analysis done. It detects the HER2 mutation, can also detect the genomic alteration. But the disadvantage is high cost. This is a flow chart, how to proceed. First, we have to do the IHC. If it is 0 or 1 plus, it is considered as negative. If it is more than 3 plus, it is considered as positive. But if the IHC is equivocal, then we have to go, we have to do the repeat, we have to repeat the FISH. In the FISH, there are three groups. HER2 gene copy number is less, the ratio is more than 2, it is considered negative. If the HER2 gene copy number is more than 6 and HER2 step ratio is less than 2, it is considered as HER2 positive. And if HER2 copy number is more than 2 but less than 6 and HER2 step ratio is less than 2, it is considered negative. The various molecules which target the HER2 pathway, which are approved by the FDA, are trastuzumab, pertuzumab, adotrastuzumab, imtansine, lapatinib, neratinib. These act in this pathway on the various paths. Trastuzumab, these act on the extracellular domain pathway. Next, the small molecule tyrosine kinase inhibitor, that is lapatinib, neratinib, these act in the intracellular domain pathway. The one more is FDA approved is tucatinib. Next, the antibody drug conjugate, that is adotrastuzumab, imantinib, it is also FDA approved and it acts in the intracellular pathway. Other drugs which are in the investigation, which are under the investigation, are margetuximab, which is the bispecific antibodies targeting the HER2 and immune cells. Now, trastuzumab, it is a humanized monoclonal antibody against HER2 receptor. It has the different various mechanism of action, like it inhibits the downstream signaling by blocking either HER2 homodimerization or ligand independent HER2 heterodimerization. It also inhibits HER2 activation by inhibiting the cleavage of its extracellular domain, thus preventing the formation of truncated and very active form of HER2, that is P95 HER2. It also induces antibody-dependent cell-mediated toxicity, which is not done by the pertuzumab. The mechanism of resistance, the persistence or reactivation, amplification of alternative tyrosine kinase receptor, or the mutation in the PI3K component, formation of insulin-like growth factor receptors, or the HER2 heterodimer. It is also not able to prevent ligand-activated HER2-HER3 or HER2-HER1 heterodimerization, which gives tumor cells a way to escape from the inhibitory effect of the trastuzumab. Pertuzumab, it is also a recombinant humanized monoclonal antibody. It binds to the extracellular domain, dimerization domain 2 of HER2, which is located exactly opposite to the side of domain 4 where the trastuzumab binds. The mechanism of inhibition is the heterodimerization of HER2 with HER1, HER3, HER4, whereas trastuzumab is preferentially active against tumors driven by HER2 homodimers. It prevents the ligand-induced dimerization of HER2 with HER3, inhibiting the activation of downstream cell signaling pathways that are critical for tumor growth. It also inhibits tumor cell growth following HRG-induced HER2 heterodimerization. Now, this is the HER receptor. This is the HER2 receptor. This is the domains 1, 2, 3, and 4. The domain 4. So that there is no homodimerization or heterodimerization, no signaling, so tumor cell arrest. But over the time, the HER globulin binds to the between the domain 1 and 3, so that domain 2 is still free and it can bind with the domain 2 of the HER2, and so there is intracellular signaling and tumor cell proliferation is there. Now, if we give pertuzumab, it will go on the domain 1, between the domain 1 and domain 3, so that domain 2 is again fixed, so that there is no signaling and then cell cycle arrest. This is another picture.
Sandeep, go back to the previous slide.
Yes, sir.
the pertuzumab binds to binds hair on the domain 2.
Pertuzumab on domain 2, yes sir.
Yes. And what is binding between 1 and 3 is herglobulin.
It's the herglobulin. It is a ligand that is herglobulin.
Yes. And you said just opposite, huh?
Sorry.
So correct yourself.
This is again the another picture showing that mechanism of action of trastuzumab plus doxorubicin. Trastuzumab again prevents the homo or heterodimerization of the HER2 and HER1, HER3, while the doxorubicin blocks the tyrosine kinase, blocks in the tyrosine kinase pathway, which leads to apoptosis. Now, another molecule, edotrastuzumab imtansine. It is an antibody drug conjugate. The components are trastuzumab, maytansinoid derivative DM1, that is a potent microtubule polymerization inhibitor, which is covalently linked to a non-cleavable thiol ether linker. It is designed to be stable in both circulation, blood circulation, and the tumor microenvironment. In 2013, FDA approved edotrastuzumab imtansine for use as a single agent for the treatment of patients with the HER2 positive metastatic breast cancer, which previously received treatment with trastuzumab or a taxane. This is the mechanism of action and the mechanism of resistance. The mechanism of action related to the trastuzumab are HER2 signaling inhibition, antibody dependent cell cytotoxicity, and HER2 shedding. So DM1 is mitotic arrest, apoptosis, mitotic catastrophe, or intracellular traffic disruption. The mechanism of resistance similar to trastuzumab is low HER2 level, masking of the epitope, shedding of the HER2, and high P95 HER2 production. The mechanism of resistance related to DM1 is drug efflux pumps or alterations in the tubulin isoforms, but the mechanism of resistance exclusive to TDM1 is defective internalization, impaired lysosomal processing, and induction of cyclin B. Lapatinib, it is an orally active, reversible HER1 and HER2 inhibitor. It is a dual kinase inhibitor that targets both HER2 and EGFR tyrosine kinase signaling pathway. It is US FDA approved for the treatment of HER2 positive metastatic breast cancer for use in combination with capecitabine in patients previously treated with standard therapies. Neratinib, it is a chloroaniloquinazoline type 2 tyrosine kinase inhibitor of HER2, which binds the ATP kinase domain in active in July 2017 in the adjuvant setting for the extended treatment of early stage HER2 positive breast cancer following trastuzumab-based therapy. It is orally active, less selective, irreversible inhibitor, also targeting HER1 and HER4. Neratinib specifically binds to the drug binding cavity of P-glycoprotein ABCB1, thereby reducing the drug efflux and enhancing the drug sensitivity, particularly in sites such as CNS basis for use in breast cancer with brain metastasis. The tucatinib, it is similar to neratinib in HER2 CLIMB trial. The addition of tucatinib to trastuzumab and capecitabine in patients with HER2 positive metastatic breast cancer with progression on trastuzumab, pertuzumab, or edotrastuzumab resulted in near doubling of the overall survival at 2 years from 26.2 to 44.9%. Now the adjuvant therapy in HER2 positive breast cancer, according to St. Gallen Consensus Conference, which is in 2017, adjuvant chemotherapy for tumors more than 4.5 centimeter or no, while the NCCN says same thing about this, but they told to add pertuzumab in addition to trastuzumab if there is node positive. Tumors that are HER2 1 plus or 2 plus without gene amplification do not benefit from trastuzumab. The optimal duration of trastuzumab therapy is 1 year. Comparison of shorter duration versus 12 months of trastuzumab therapy has shown superiority for the 12-month duration. According to HERA trial, they compared 1 year versus 2 years of therapy and they found no benefit for the second year. Trastuzumab is active when it is delivered sequentially after chemotherapy, as in HERA trial, or concurrently with chemotherapy, as in NSCBP B31 or BCIRAC trials. However, concurrent trastuzumab and chemotherapy administration yielded superior results as compared to sickle cell therapy. This is a chart from the Devita, which shows the different trials for like NSCBP trial, HERA trial, FINHER trial, or BCIRAC trial. They all started, gave trastuzumab for 1 year. They all chose the disease trastuzumab for 1 year. All of the adjuvant trastuzumab trials gave chemotherapy. There are no data on whether trastuzumab would be effective without adjuvant chemotherapy. These are the ExtraNet trial, which is published in 2017. They compared trastuzumab plus neratinib versus trastuzumab only. The duration is 52 weeks. They showed the improved overall survival, disease-free survival, and reduces the recurrence. The side effect is diarrhea, which is more in the trastuzumab plus neratinib group. Another trial, Affinity, which is also published in 2017, they compared trastuzumab plus pertuzumab versus trastuzumab only. The duration is 52 weeks, and they also showed improved overall survival and disease-free survival. They also reduces the breast cancer events. There is the side. A more specific point is there is no increase in the cardiomyopathy. Another trial, the ALTO trial, it has two designs. Trial design one is trastuzumab plus lapatinib versus trastuzumab for 52 weeks, and second is trastuzumab for 12 weeks followed by lapatinib for 34 weeks versus trastuzumab alone. This trial again shows improves overall survival and disease-free survival in the trastuzumab plus lapatinib. Neratinib reduces the recurrence in ER-positive, HER2-positive cancers, but not in the hormone receptor-negative, HER2-positive evolving. At present, it seems most appropriate in higher risk, that is, node-positive breast cancers that are hormone receptor-positive and HER2-positive also. Addition of pertuzumab in Affinity study reduces the risk of breast cancer events, particularly in the high-risk node-positive tumors. Now, in the neoadjuvant setting, there are four trials which shows like neo-ALTO trial. This trial compared trastuzumab plus lapatinib versus trastuzumab for 52 weeks. This shows increase in the pathological complete response in both breast and nodes. It reduces the overall recurrence risk and improves the disease-free survival and overall survival. Another trial, that is Neosphere trial, CalGB trial, and NSBP B41 trial, they gave trastuzumab for 12 or 16 weeks. They again showed the increase in breast on nodes, and they improved the clinical response rates. They increased the overall survival and disease-free survival. Now in the metastatic breast cancer, the first-line treatment is trastuzumab. When added to the first-line chemotherapy for HER2-positive metastatic breast cancer, they improve the response rate, time of to progression, and overall survival. Concurrent administration of trastuzumab and anthracycline should be avoided as cardiomyopathy could be precipitated. It should be screened by serial determinations of the left ventricular ejection fraction. The clinical evaluation of pertuzumab and trastuzumab Cleopatra study compared the trastuzumab and pertuzumab as the first-line treatment for the HER2-positive breast cancer. It shows improvement in both progression-free survival and overall survival. After achieving a marked clinical response, chemotherapy can be withheld while the patient continues on the maintenance trastuzumab and pertuzumab treatment. Another group is hormone receptor-positive and HER2-positive metastatic breast cancer. Addition of anti-HER2 treatments to endocrine therapy yields modest improvement in progression-free survival. After induction phase, chemotherapy is withheld and endocrine therapy is initiated while continuing maintenance. Currently, data for the use of trastuzumab and pertuzumab are limited to the concurrent administration with taxane-based chemotherapy only. Now, trastuzumab refractory HER2-positive breast cancer. Trastuzumab continuation beyond progression is associated with improvement in time to progression, and it justifies the practice of continued anti-HER2 blockade. We can also use lapatinib, which is a dual kinase inhibitor that targets both HER2 and EGFR tyrosine kinase signaling pathway. It has been studied as a second line anti-HER2 therapy for patients with disease progression after chemotherapy plus capecitabine, as compared to capecitabine alone, is associated with longer period of tumor control and improvement in response rate, but not in the survival. Adotrastuzumab emtansine is compared to lapatinib and capecitabine. It so improves progression-free survival, overall survival for the adotrastuzumab emtansine, and tolerability is more efficiently in the trastuzumab-resistant metastatic breast cancer, which is efficiently shown in EMILIA trial. Continue to T-DM1 continue to receive clinical benefit from the patients continue to receive clinical benefits from the multiple lines of the anti-HER2 therapy and can have tumor responses even after progression on the T-DM1. The different trials, the Cleopatra trial, which is recently published in its results in 2020, it is the first line treatment. The trastuzumab free interval is more than 12 months. The treatment arms were docetaxel plus trastuzumab plus pertuzumab versus docetaxel plus trastuzumab. It shows progression-free survival of 18.7 months as compared to 12.4 months and 5 months as compared to 40.8 months in the control arm. The EMILIA trial, it is a second line treatment after progression on the trastuzumab or taxanes, or trastuzumab free interval is less than 6 months. It compared adotrastuzumab versus lapatinib plus capecitabine. It shows slightly more progression free survival, but the overall survival was not very different. The Theresa trial, it is after second line, that is after progression on the taxanes, trastuzumab and anthracycline. Adotrastuzumab versus, it kind of the physician's choice. It shows overall survival of 22.7 months versus 15.8 months. One study done by Gear et al. It compares that lapatinib plus capecitabine versus capecitabine alone. The overall survival was not very much different. It is almost same by 15.6 months, and progression free survival is also not very different. Another trial EGF1049 double. It is a more than compared lapatinib plus trastuzumab versus lapatinib alone. The progression free survival was 11 weeks in the experimental versus 8 weeks on the lapatinib alone arm, and the overall survival was 14 months versus 11 months. To conclude my point, the first line of the HER2 positive should be the taxanes plus trastuzumab plus pertuzumab, as shown in the Cleopatra trial, or we can also give adotrastuzumab if patient can patient develop any side effects or patient can tolerate this. The second line, the best sequencing is not defined. We can use capecitabine plus lapatinib, or trastuzumab plus cytotoxic chemotherapy, or trastuzumab plus lapatinib. Or we can also use adotrastuzumab as in the Theresa trial. Thank you.
Sandeep, what is the place of surgery here?
Surgery can be done in the surgery can be done upfront or after giving the trastuzumab and cytotoxic therapy in the therapy after the neoadjuvant chemotherapy, or surgery can be done, and after that anti-HER2 drugs can be given in the adjuvant.
What are the recommendations when it should be done for early breast cancers and locally advanced breast cancers?
For early breast cancer, if possible, we should go for straight away for MRM or for BCS, and after that we can give chemotherapy along with trastuzumab.
See, the point of debate in HER2 positive breast cancer is, should anti-HER2 therapies be initiated at the beginning or not? And this is the only controversy which is there. In a metastatic setting, the answers are clear. In the adjuvant setting, the answers are clear. In the locally advanced, new adjuvant options are clear. What is not clear is, what should be done in the early breast cancers? because all these studies have shown that there is a better response rate when the anti-HER2 strategies are started upfront.
The three studies which showed anti-HER2 trastuzumab should be given for 12 to 16 weeks. It increases the pathological complete response in the breast and also improves the overall survival and the progression-free survival.
So then why did you answer that surgery should be done first? See, I expected you to discuss the clinical scenarios, but I think as you have not discussed, there will be questions coming and we will take them as they come.
Positive as well as ER positive. This patient came today. This is a T2N2 disease, sir. I want to give neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by surgery because patient wants BCS.
Yeah.
Now, my medical oncologist came with a doubt that he wants me to do the surgery first. Because N2 is, because of conglomerate lymph node, that can be cleared. It's not that inoperable N2. Because he's saying is, if I have to give trastuzumab with a pertuzumab, along with pertuzumab and chemotherapy, I'll give the loading dose once. And if I, like I told him, give 3 cycles, and after each cycle, let the patient come to me. Before the lump resolves, I do a BCS and then you continue with the usual adjuvant therapy. But he was quite insisting on me to do the surgery first, which will be the correct approach in this.
See, N2 will be stage 3, which will be locally advanced breast cancer, and recommendation will be to go for anti-HER2 therapies along with the chemotherapies first. So the best combination, yes. Best combination will be TCH, a taxane with the platinum with the Herceptin to start with. If you don't want to start docetaxel with pertuzumab and trastuzumab, that will be other combination that you can start with. If the patient can afford trastuzumab, I think army can afford. So the best option for her will be to go for docetaxel, pertuzumab and trastuzumab. Let it continue for 1 year. And then you do the surgery, give radiation, and continue with the pertuzumab for another year. Karthik is asking, if the tumor is refractory to Trastuzumab, then it is refractory to pertuzumab too. I think, Karthik, you missed the slide on the mechanism. The reason for, one of the reasons for trastuzumab not working is heterodimerization of the HER2 receptor. If there is a heterodimerization, the trastuzumab doesn't work. But in presence of pertuzumab, when both drugs are given together, even if there is a heterodimerization, it blocks the ligand binding on the heterodimer and it will work. So a combination will work even if the trastuzumab is not working alone. And Rashmi is asking importance of PCR in HER2 positive. Well, Rashmi, this is something which is being discussed. It has not yet come into the guidelines. But yes, a lot of people are discussing it and discussing it out loud. There was a ESCO position paper also, which was published this year. And that has also, I had circulated it to everybody also, that where they are now discussing that the people who respond to anti-HER2 therapies, because the PCR rate is almost 48%. So one of the most important thing is that if you are taking a patient for a preoperative anti-HER2 therapy, you have to clip the tumor, you have to clip the node if it is there, and then proceed with the treatment, because 48% of the time you are not going to find the tumor, or in half the cases you are not going to find the tumor there when you go back after a year. And it is one of the positive, it is one of the prognostic factors in HER2 positive tumors, that those who respond to anti-HER2 therapy have a better survival than those who do not respond to HER2 therapies.
Hello.
Yeah, Bhavna.
There was one meta-analysis published long back, and they say the PCR rate is significantly higher when you use a concurrent trastuzumab with anthracycline based chemotherapy compared to you use non-trastuzumab therapy. So that is the only thing which PCR increases is trastuzumab and anthracycline.
Yeah, it also increases the complication rate. That's why if you have to use both trastuzumab and anthracycline, you have to be very, very careful. So that is why most of the trials that you are, that is why most of the recent trials that you are going to see, they are using docetaxel with trastuzumab.
Correct. Non-anthracycline based chemotherapy.
Yes. If you use and if you also see the platinum drugs has very good response rate in HER2 positive tumors also.
Correct. Even that is for the small tumors with HER2 positive. They say APT trial, which was actually not given very good response. But if you give a non-anthracycline based chemotherapy with trastuzumab, the cardiotoxicity will be very, very less.
Yes. So the PCH regime, as I said, as I told Arnab, the taxane with the platinum with trastuzumab, if you do not want to use the dual blockade, or use trastuzumab, pertuzumab with docetaxel. Both these regimes work wonderfully well. And AC can be reserved for metastatic disease later in life if it happens. Rashmi is asking for complications. The complication rates when you are going for a dual blockade are much higher. So if you look at the complication wise, then a taxane with a platinum and trastuzumab is safer compared to dual blockade, because in the dual blockade, the even the treatment related mortality is approximately 1-2%, and neutropenia is one of the major complications. GI complications are much higher. So when you are going for a dual, most of the series has up to 3% mortality rate. Am I right, Sandeep? Treatment related mortality is up to 3%.
Yes.
In the studies. Anshika, yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, my question is regarding when even after dual blockade of HER2, there is progression of disease, whether it is in the adjuvant setting or it's in the metastatic setting. In that, would we prefer capecitabine or T-DM1 or lapatinib? What would be preferred in that setting?
When we are talking of progression, we will not be talking on the adjuvant, because in the adjuvant, there will be no progression. Only new metastasis or new lesions can appear. So when we actually talk of progression, we are talking of palliative settings most of the time. Am I right?
Sir, we recently had a patient where she had presented with early, and we did the BCS, one of our colleagues in the team. And thereafter, they received the adjuvant systemic chemotherapy as well as combination HER2 blockade. And while that was going on, within the 1 year of treatment, she developed local as well as lymph nodal axillary fixed disease, which was FNAC proven, and no other systemic disease through PET scan. So in that setting, regarding that patient, what would we do now? We have done the BCS and radiation, everything is done.
I think the best thing to do is take a biopsy and recheck the ERPR HER2 status. That is the first thing that should be done. Because one of the pitfalls of relying only on IHC is that IHC has some limitations in interpretation. And you have to interpret the IHC results with caution. If your pathologist is good, you know that your pathologist is good, then it's fine. But otherwise, sometimes you may get a positive report even in a negative tumor. And you have to remember, Anshika, that any patient who is HER2 positive or 3 positive on ISC, 3 positive means greater than 75% of the cells showing HER2 receptors. That means 25% of the population or the clonality in that tumor, within that tumor, does not have the HER2 receptor positive. And what happens is when you do a HER2 targeted treatment, the HER2 positive cells may die, but then the other cells which are not expressing HER2 will start to proliferate. So multiclonality of the tumors is one of the factors which is less understood as of today. And that is why the HER2 targeting with chemotherapy is better, because chemotherapy will target cells which are non-HER2 positive cells. And that is why they say that the combination works always better than only HER2 therapies. In this case, a dual blockade with docetaxel would have been given, I think. Anshika?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It was given.
Yeah. So your option is, if it is only the local recurrences, you can go for an MRM and take out the lymph node, do an axillary clearance. That is one option. And then follow her up with the anthracycline-based chemotherapy.
Sure, sir. Yes.
And
it was also our plan. Yes, sir.
Yeah, do look for receptor status again and see what has happened to the receptor status. Tarun wants to add something.
Thank you, sir.
I wanted to ask, I agree, neoadjuvant Herceptin or neoadjuvant trastuzumab has a benefit in terms of PFS. But as far as OS is concerned, sir, I mean, is it beneficial in when we look at OS, overall survival of
the patient? See, the if you look at the long-term follow-up, most of the studies which have been using the neoadjuvant dual blockade are just 3 or 4 years back. They started. So, so far, if we are talking of early breast cancers, we are talking of 10-year survivals, 10-year survival to the tune of 80%. So, until unless these studies come out with their long-term results, we will not know what is the effect on the overall survival. But yes, there is definite advantage in terms of progression-free survivals. And how much it is going to translate into overall survival, probably in another 5 years, we will have a very clear picture when the long-term results of these trials are published. Because in metastatic setting and adjuvant setting, in both the setting, it is showing a benefit on overall survival. So if a drug is showing a doubling of overall survival in metastatic setting and doubling of overall survival in adjuvant setting, why it will not do it in a new adjuvant setting? There is no reason that it should not increase overall survival. So rationally or logically, it should. But then there is no data at present to show that at 10 years, it is improving the survival.
But isn't it similar to new adjuvant chemotherapy, sir? I mean, isn't it similar to new adjuvant chemotherapy?
It may not be, Tarun. It may not be because the new adjuvant chemotherapy, when compared with adjuvant therapy, and when we are talking of the older NSABP trials, were the trials which were done without even looking at the receptor status. Now the treatment is being stratified by receptor status. And we know that there are tumors which are bad responders and there are tumors which are good responders. So, until and unless we have data on these tumors by the receptor status, it is very difficult to say. It is quite possible that in a HER2, it may not be same. If we do not look at the receptor, probably it is the same. But if we look at the receptor status and do target the receptor, the response might be much, much, much more different. Much different. So triple negative and HER2 positive are two different tumors. And that is what is coming out, that they also have subsets. They have a subset which responds, which will do better. They have a subset which does not respond, will do bad. So it's quite possible that we may find that in HER2 receptor positive disease, if you target HER2 early, you may have an overall survival advantage. Because complete response rate is up to 48%. So 30 to 48%. which is quite a high number. So that means at least 1/3 of your patients are going to do well. So how much well they were going to do compared to 2/3 which are not going to do so well will actually decide the effect on the overall survival.
Sir, anyway, the intratumoral HER2-new heterogeneity is around 16 to 36%.
Yes.
So these patients are not going to respond. They will progress and have a metastasis even if you give a trastuzumab therapy.
Yes, but this heterodimerization is taken care of when you use dual blockade. But our problem is that when the moment you want to do the dual blockage, your cost per month goes to about 2.5 to 3 lakhs.
Correct.
So not many of my patients are able to afford 3 lakh rupees per month therapy. Karthik is asking, in patients new adjuvant HER2 therapy, when to do surgery in responding tumors? Once PCR is achieved or after completion of full course? In most of the studies that has been done for new adjuvant chemotherapy, the treatment has been done, the surgery has been done after completion of the anti-HER2 therapies.
Sir, I think Dr. Sandeep has covered everything, sir. I think only one Catherine trial, there it has come last year, sir. I think you mentioned it to ASCO 2019.
Yes.
So what they have said is PCR.
So if there are no more questions and we have lost Srijan, so I'll
sir.
Thank. Yes, Srijan. Yeah. Yeah.
Sir, so I think that's what you said. It's not come in guideline, but I think it will come in future. That if residual is present, like in triple negative, capecitabine is to be added. Maybe here we have to change from trastuzumab to T-DM1.
Yes. Probably they are going to come up with a position paper soon. That is where the people are concentrating on right now.
Yes.
Sir, if a patient in this situation not able to afford T-DM1, so I was wondering if capecitabine in that situation, will it be helpful for this kind of patient?
We don't know, Anshika. There is no data on capecitabine. There is a little bit of data on capecitabine and lapatinib as third line. But even that data
equivocal
is not...
results, yes, sir.
Equivocal results. It's like yes, 4 months and 11 months. So it's not something which is very encouraging and looking forward to. But if you have not used anthracyclines, I'll suggest that you use anthracycline. Because most of the studies have not used anthracycline in the first go and have not used anthracyclines even later on. So, if you look at the drugs which do well in breast cancer, the anthracyclines, the taxanes and the platinums are the three best compounds. So if these, any of the three has not been used earlier, I think they should be used because as a single agent, they have the best response rate against the breast cancers. So it makes sense to use the best drugs against breast cancer rather than using a fourth drug where we don't know what kind of response rate it will have.
Thank you, sir. I wanted to compliment the doctor. He made a very good presentation. He summarized the all the publications in a tabular form, which made us very easy for us to understand what he was trying to say. It was a very good presentation, sir.
Thank you, Anshika. And thank you, everybody, for your participation.